Welcome everyone. So this is Amir Sheikh. Welcome to the inorganic chemistry lecture. So today we will discuss about one of the well-known coordination theory in coordination chemistry or from inorganic chemistry. That theory is called crystal field theory. After that valence bond theory, the second task is crystal field theory. Now crystal field theory is due to there is some limitation in the valence bond theory. And this theory is first given by Van Vleck and Hans Bethe. This theory is given by Van Vleck and Hans Bethe, while this valence bond theory is given by Linus Pauling. Now, what is the actual cause for crystal field theory? And what are the limitations of our VBT theory? Okay, according to that valence bond theory, the metal ligand bonding is perfectly covalent in nature. What is that covalent in nature? That means there is a overlapping of filled orbital of ligand with the vacant orbital of the metal. And basically that type of the bond will originate, that will be the form, the coordinate covalent bond. Okay, so I will picturize you what actually happened in case of what valence bond theory. So valence bond theory is very well known for identification of structures, hybridization, the geometry, magnetic properties and nature of the complexes. Okay, these are the some outcomes of valence bond theory. And if you see the actual phenomena that will be appeared for valence bond theory, in this case the ligand is treated as a Lewis base because it is a lone pair donor, while this metal is act as a Lewis acid, lone pair acceptor, that will form a coordinate covalent bond. This is the one the outcomes, or one can say the postulates of valence bond theory. Now we will be going to learn about the crystal field theory. Okay, and before that you must know the defects of our crystal defects of valence bond theory. Valence bond theory can't explain the rate of reaction in the complexes, right? This is the first limitation. Valence bond theory cannot explain the spectras of complexes, particularly for transition series, and also can't explain the colors of the complexes. VBT can't explain why some complexes can only form octahedral complexes, why not square plane or tetrahedral. VBT also can't explain the participation of d orbitals. These are the important limitations or the defects of valence bond theory. To overcome this, so we have a new theory which is introduced by Van Vleck and Hans Bethe. The theory is called as a crystal field theory. Now, what are the postulates of crystal field theory? So first, you know that metal is surrounded or coordinated with a certain number of ligands. You know that ligands are nothing but the electron rich species. They are able to donate the electron pair to the vacant orbital of the metal ion according to VBT. So ligands are either neutral or either they have negative charge. Okay, the neutral ligands are nothing but the they having lone pairs, or negative charge ligands nothing but the they have the charge. So according to that CFT, ligand is treated as a point charge and dipole. What is that point charge? Whenever the ligands having negative charge, they are treated as a point charge, or those ligand having neutral or the lone pair, they are treated as a point dipole. Okay, so basically both the species have negative charge. So example, I have put the example is cyanide. So cyanide is the ligand where negative charge is there, so they are called as a point charge. While water is a neutral ligand, so they act as a point dipole. So in case of our crystal field theory, first point is ligand is treated as a point charge or point dipole. Okay, now, and in general, whenever we have negative species and positive species, there must be some ionic interaction will be developed. We will see in the next point. Okay, central metal cation, that is your metal ion, surrounded by fixed number or surrounded by ligands which contain electron pair. Ionic ligands are act as a point charge and neutral ligands are act as a point dipole. So bonding between this metal and ligand is electrostatic. Why? Because ligands are negatively charged species, they have electron density, they will be attracted, they will be interacted with the positive metal ion, and there is an interaction will be there, that is called purely electrostatic interaction or Coulombic attraction. Okay, between this positively charged metal ion and negatively charged the ligand. So according to this crystal field theory, the bond between metal and ligand is purely ionic. We will see in these two figure where fluoride as a ligand and ammonia as a ligand. In both the cases, what electron density is there? They will be attracted toward the metal ion. So that type of the force of attraction is called as a Coulombic attraction, or also called as a ionic interaction. So this is the first difference between valence bond theory and crystal field theory. According to valence bond theory, it is a purely covalent in nature, while according to CFT, it is an ionic in nature. Okay, likewise. So if we have more than one donor site is an ligand. For example, we have hydroxylamine. NH2OH is a bidentate ligand. One can say it have two donor atom. One is nitrogen, second is oxygen. But only nitrogen is able to donate the pair of electron. Why? Because nitrogen having less electronegativity or least electronegative than what the oxygen. So according to that spectrochemical series, like carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and halogen donor ligand. This is what summary of spectrochemical series. Carbon donor ligands are more easily available for donation than nitrogen, than oxygen, than what halogen, because donation power increases with decreasing electronegativity. Okay, now we have types of a d orbital. You know that the d orbitals are classified on the basis of what? Their lobes. Their lobes are present on axis, they are called axial orbital. Where the lobes are present in between the axis, they are called the non-axial orbital. So first category of d orbital is called as a axial orbital, that is classified as a dz square, dx square minus y square. While a non-axial orbital set is nothing but their lobes are occupied in between the axis. And what actually present in the lobes? In the lobes, there is an electron density. So one can simply call as axial orbital having more electron density on the axis, while non-axial orbitals are those orbital where electron density is occupied in between the axis. These are the metal d orbital. And you know that whenever the ligand is approached, and ligands are approached from axis, that's why the axial orbital will undergo the more repulsion, will face the more repulsion. This is the cause of splitting of d orbital, and that will be perfectly explained by Hans Bethe and Van Vliet. This is the first advantage over what the valence bond theory. Okay, this axial set is also called as EG, while non-axial set is also called as T2G. This E and T2 terms are appeared from symmetry. And what is G now? G is nothing but the Girard. According to that Greek letter, Girard means centrosymmetric. You know that D orbitals are centrosymmetric, like X orbital. S orbital also centrosymmetric. That's why we are mentioning the term small g. Okay, you know that we have total 5 orbitals are there, SPDF, and their electron occupancy is for S orbital 2 electron, for P 6 electron, D 10 electron, and for F there are total 14 electrons will be occupied maximally, and their L values are given 0, 1, 2, 3. L means azimuthal quantum number. Okay, so there are total 5 sets of a d orbital. When all the 5 set of d orbitals are in a same energy level, then that type of what orbitals are called a degenerate orbital. And degenerate orbitals includes axial set and non-axial set. What is axial set now? Those orbitals are lobes are present on axis. So axial orbitals are x square minus y square and z square, while these are called as a non-axial, where you can term as a xy, yz and xz. So that axials are two orbitals in one set, while non-axials are 3 orbitals in one set. So one can call it as a doubly and triply degenerate orbitals. Okay, so actually this is what octahedral figure. We will see the first crystal field splitting in octahedral complexes, and out of this we have 4 orbital. S and d orbitals are centrosymmetric character. Okay, we will first going to see the how metal ligands interact, how this purely ionic interaction is there. You know that metal having both type of electron density, metal having positive charge, okay, also having electrons in orbitals. You know that ligands are perfectly their negatively charged species, they have having pair of electron. So these ligands attracted to the positive electron density of metal ion, positive nuclear density of metal ion. So this force is called as attractive forces, as we show in this figure. What? So this negative charge is attracted to this one, and this one is also attracted to this one. So this call type of interaction is called as a attractive force. But you know that this negative charge on the ligand and some electron density on the metal ion, they will be undergo the repulsion. So this is a cause of what? Splitting of d orbitals. Okay, we will see first one. This is actually the perfect octahedral geometry of any complex. How it will be now? So in the absence of any field, that is only metal is there. So we have five set of orbitals are in a same energy level, and that is called, in the absence of ligand field, all the d orbitals are in a degenerate state. Degeneracy means one, we have equivalent energy. Okay, so now, so when the ligands are approaches, what happened? So there is a one hypothetical concept, hypothetical phenomena is appeared. So where metal d orbital raise their energy, and secondly what, just when the ligands are influenced to this orbital, so they will be undergo the what, repulsion between the axial orbital. Because you know that I already told you that the axial orbitals means their lobes are present on axis and ligands are oriented in axial direction. That's why the axial orbitals undergo the repulsion. So they will be raise their energy. Okay, in some sort of a day will raise the energy, and thus T2g orbital, that is triply degenerate orbital, there lower the energy to stabilize that your this axial orbit. And that's why the splitting is occurred due to the presence of a ligand field. So this splitting is called as a crystal field splitting. This theory is explained in first the ionic crystals, and this is a field effect where ligands are approaches in a specific way, specific path. That's why this theory is called as a crystal field theory, and there is a splitting is occurred, and that splitting is nothing but called as a crystal field splitting. So by using that crystal field splitting, we can find out the crystal field stabilization energy. Okay, and here is the figure that will showing that how this ligand field is responsible to split that Eg and T2g orbital. If the ligand field is more, then splitting will be a large. If the ligand field is less, then splitting will be a less now. So depending on that, we have two types of bondings will be developed. One is a metal ligand strong bond and metal ligand weak bond. So weak bond is responsible for weak field ligand, and this one is for what, the strong field ligand. So how the your ligands are interacted with the metal ion, and finally you will get the splitting of the orbital will be takes place. So this is actually the phenomena where we can call as a splitting of a d orbital will be takes place. Okay, so yes, we have two different pictures are given now. So what is the effect of a ligands in the splitting? Now you know that in a strong field ligand, means carbon donor ligand, say example, they effectively attracted toward the metal ion, and repulsion also more. So more del zero cap will be there, or more splitting will be takes place between these two energy levels. And in this case, small energy level is there. Why? Because of your ligands is weak field, and so it cannot repel more. Oh, that's why the repulsion will be less. So splitting also what, less. This is the one first picture where the we can showing that effect of a ligand field onto the your splitting. Then next one, we have two types of complexes are there, octahedral complexes, tetrahedral complexes. Obviously octahedral complexes always have more crystal field splitting than what the tetrahedral, because of what, because of octahedral complexes consist of six ligands, while in tetrahedral only four ligands are there. So more the number of ligand, more will be the what, repulsion will be takes place. Okay, and this is actually the figure. You know that tetrahedral complexes are reverse splitting than what octahedral, because their orbitals are different. Okay, in octahedral family, your axial orbitals are Eg, which are present on axis. That's why they undergo the repulsion, so they raise their energy. While in case of what tetrahedral complexes, no one orbitals are present on axis, so your ligands are coming from what, the non-axial side. So non-axial side means T2, they will raise the energy. So this is the difference between octahedral and tetrahedral complexes. Difference is very simple. In octahedral complexes, axial orbitals are Eg, they will undergo the repulsion. Okay, while in case of what tetrahedral complexes, no one orbitals are present on the axis, so ligands are approached from on the non-axial set, and that's why T2 will raise their energy. And as per the ligands, 4 in octahedral and 6 in octahedral and 4 in tetrahedral, the splitting will be decided. Now what types of the ligands? Now you know that according to that spectrochemical series, we have carbon donor, nitrogen donor, oxygen donor and halogen donor. You know that carbon donors are less electronegative, so they will be also be act as a strong field system. So metal ligand bond is very strong, while in case of a halogen donor system, metal ligand bond is weak now. And If we use the strong field ligand, the separation of EG and T2G will be more, that is axial and equatorial orbitals are more, while in this case the splitting is less now. This is the difference between these two types of ligand. So how to find out the CFAC now? CFAC is nothing but the crystal field stabilization energy, and for octahedral complexes it must be 10 dq. So this gap between these two is a 10 dq, or also called as a del O. Okay, and separation between this EG and T2G is a 10 dq. So to stabilize that EG orbital required 0.6, or release the 0.6, and here minus 0.4. So by these two one can be find out the equation to finding the crystal field stabilization energy, that CFAC is equal to minus 0.4 into the electrons in T2G level plus 0.6 into electrons in EG level into del O, or we can have the same equation. Okay, this is the actually for crystal field stabilization energy. Now what is pairing energy? Now the pairing energy is a concept which is appeared due to, in case of a strong field ligand, all the electrons are paired, they violated the Hund's rule. But in case of weak field ligand, the Hund's rule will be followed, Hund's rule will be obeyed. So what is the pairing energy now? A pairing energy is nothing but the amount of energy required to pair the two electrons against electron-electron repulsion. So the energy which is required to pair these two electrons against this electron-electron repulsion, and generally it is calculated by the number, that is Np, where N is a number of unpaired electrons. So this is actually the concept of a pairing energy. Okay, so we have some examples. We have to apply that example. Your first complex is titanium hexa-aqua system, hexa-aqua titanium 3. So first find out the oxidation state. So here water is a neutral ligand, so must be the plus 3 oxidation state of titanium. According to the electronic configuration, the argon 3d1 4s0 is the oxidation state of titanium. Now we have only one electron, so one electron will be occupied at here before the comp. Now whenever your ligands are approaches, your complex becomes a t2g1 and ag0 will be the configuration. So t2g1 will be the configuration. If you have a d2 system, then electron will be again occupied at the T2G level. If electrons are 3 now, then electrons will be occupied at the this system T2G3. That means for D1, D2 and D3, whatever type of ligands are there, they both have what? Same configuration. Okay, that is what D1, D2, D3, all the ligands are equivalent, either weak field or either strong field. Same thing is for D8, D9 and D10, but only the case is different for D4, D5, D6, D7. So strong field, weak field, both are different. Okay, so whenever we have complex having strong field ligand, they form low spin complex. Okay, while whenever the complex having weak field ligand, they form a high spin complex. Okay, so this is all about the crystal field splitting in octahedral as well as the tetrahedral complexes. So remaining terms definitely learn in the definitely in the next session. So we'll be see this one. So stay connected for this, and if any kind of you get any kind of a doubt regarding this one, so mention in the comment box. And thank you for watching this lecture. This is one of the most important topic in the inorganic chemistry for coordination compounds, particularly that is called the crystal field theory. So thank you, stay connected, stay safe.